Hello friends, in today's video, we will derive the Planck's law of radiation. In the previous class, we have already seen the Planck's quantum hypothesis. We saw the background in which this hypothesis was developed. In order to explain the blackbody radiation, the classical theory was not sufficient to bring out the blackbody radiation spectra. So if you plot the wavelength along the x-axis and the energy density along the y-axis, then the blackbody radiation spectrum has a shape as given in this picture. So we have already discussed various features of this curve, and the classical theory proposed by Wien or Raleigh and Jean or any other classical theories that was proposed was not able to properly explain this blackbody radiation spectrum. So in this context, the Planck developed quantum theory to explain the blackbody radiation. And according to Planck's quantum hypothesis, a blackbody chamber is filled with simple harmonic oscillators. Suppose we have a black body, it can be assumed to be composed of a lot of simple harmonic oscillators of molecular dimension. And these oscillators are emitting radiations, and that is the black body radiation. And the energies that are emitted by these oscillators are only multiples of h nu, integral multiples of h nu. So all ranges of energies cannot be emitted by these oscillators. Only integral multiples of h nu energies can be emitted, can be radiated. And these oscillators can choose different frequencies. The nu can be varied, but for particular value of nu, the energy is not continuous, but integral multiple of h nu. For example, if an oscillator is oscillating at a frequency nu, then it can choose energy h nu or 2h nu or 3h nu and so on, and no energies in between can be chosen. So this is what Planck assumed in order to explain the blackbody radiation. So with this assumption, we will be moving forward and we will be trying to make an explanation for the blackbody radiation. So first of all, let us try to write an equation for the total number of oscillators or the total number of Planck resonators. So, total number of Planck resonators let me call that term as capital N, and this is equal to N0 is the number of oscillators with energy 0. So number of resonators with energy 0. If N0 is the number of resonators with energy 0, then the number of resonators with energy E is given by N0 into e raised to minus e by kT. So this is obtained from the Maxwell distribution law. If N0 is the number of resonators at the ground level, then the number of resonators at energy E can be calculated using the Maxwell distribution law. So similarly, the number of resonators with energy 2E what will be that? It will be equal to N0 e raised to minus 2E by kT. where 2 is the energy of those resonators. So this is how the number of resonators will increase, or the number of resonators will vary with respect to energies. So what will be the total number of resonators? It will be the sum of all these resonators. There are some resonators with energy 0 and its number is N0. Then there are some resonators with energy E. Its number is N0 e raised to minus E by KT. Then there are resonators with energy 2E and whose number is given by this term, and the list will continue like this. So if I want to calculate the total number of resonators, Planck's resonators in a black body, then it should be the sum of all these terms, that is N plus N0 e raised to minus E by KT plus N0 e raised to minus 2E by KT plus etc. and so on. So here E is the energy, which is actually h nu. We have already defined that according to Planck's quantum hypothesis, the energies that can be chosen are integral multiples of h nu. So the E stands for h nu here. And T is the temperature, K is the Boltzmann constant, N0 is the number of resonators with energy 0, and so on. So the total number of resonators can be calculated using the equation as given here. Now moving on, let me substitute x equal to E by KT. So I'm going to make a substitution, x equal to E by KT. Then the series can be simplified as N equal to N0 plus N0 e raised to minus x plus N0 e raised to minus 2x plus other terms. And similarly, if you consider this term, this is equal to N0 multiplied by 1 plus e raised to minus x plus e raised to minus 2x plus the remaining of the terms, e raised to minus 3x and so on. So this is a series expansion, right? This is a series expansion with terms like 1 plus x plus x square plus and so on. This is a series expansion that goes like this. And have you studied the simplification of this kind of series expansion? If the series is 1 plus x plus x square plus etc., then it can be simplified as 1 by 1 minus x. So similarly, here we have a series expansion. Instead of x, we have e raised to minus x. And hence, I can simplify this equation as N0 into 1 by 1 minus, instead of x, I will be writing e raised to minus x. So this is the total number of resonators, Planck's resonators, that will be present in a black body. Now let us move on and calculate the total energy of the Planck's resonators. So let me write capital E. So this term will be representing the total energy of all the oscillators. And initially we have N0 number of resonators with 0 energy. So I am going to multiply N0 with 0 because their energy is 0. Then we have N0 into e raised to minus x number of resonators with energy E, which is h nu. Then we have N0 e raised to minus 2x number of resonators with energy 2E, and so on. So there are plenty of number of resonators with different levels of energy. And 0, E, 2E, etc. are the energies of different resonators. And these are the numbers of those resonators. N0 resonators with 0 energy, N0 e raised to minus x resonators with E energy, and so on. So if I simplify this equation, what you will get? It will be equal to 0 plus E N0 e raised to minus x plus 2E N0 e raised to minus 2x plus etc. And if I calculate e into e raised to minus 6. That if I am going to multiply this equation 2 with another term e raised to minus x, then what will be the equation? It will be equal to multiply each of the terms with e raised to minus x, right? I have multiplied with an e raised to minus x on the left hand side. So on the right hand side as well, you need to multiply an e raised to minus x with each of the terms. So it will be e into n0 e raised to minus 2x, because now we are multiplying this term with another e raised to minus x, plus 2e into n0 e raised to minus 3x plus etc. So this step is simply done for a simplification process, as we will see later. So what is equation 2 minus equation 3? Equation 2 minus equation 3, what will be the answer? On the left hand side, you need to draw e minus e raised to minus x. And on the right hand side, you have to subtract each of the terms. So e into n0 e raised to minus x. There are no terms with e raised to minus x power here. So I am going to just write that term e into n0 e raised to minus x. Now this term is over. Now we have an e raised to minus 2x term in the equation 2, but there is one another term e into n0 e raised to minus 2x in equation 3, and if you subtract that, 2 times a term minus 1 time that term, that is happening here. So what will be the answer? It will be just e into n0 e raised to minus 2x, isn't it so? So you can calculate and find this term will subtract with this term and will yield you e into n0 e raised to minus 2x. Then after that term, you have actually another term, that is 3e into n0 e raised to minus 3x. That will be the next term in this series. So there you can again subtract 3e n0 e raised to minus 3x minus 2e n0 e raised to minus 3x. So what will be the next term in this series? It will be simply e into n0 e raised to minus 3x, and so on. So this is a series. Again, a series is obtained. So simply, I am going to simplify this equation. So you can take e into n0 as common. Then there are terms e raised to minus x, e raised to minus 2x, and so on. So this is equal to, I am going to take e into n0 into e raised to minus x as common. Then the rest of the terms are 1 plus, isn't it so? Here if you take e into n0 e raised to minus x, the remaining is 1. Here if you take that term as common, the remaining term is e raised to minus x plus e raised to minus 2x, and so on. So have you seen this series before? So we have come across this kind of series, 1 plus, x squared plus, so on. And how do you simplify such a series? Such a series is simply 1 by 1 minus x. So I am going to replace that series by e into n0 e raised to minus x into 1 by 1 minus e raised to minus x. So on the left hand side, we have e into e minus e raised to e minus e into e raised to minus x. So if I simplify that side, it is e into 1 minus e raised to minus x. So what is energy E? The total energy of all the resonators, or the total energy of the black body, is simply e into n0 e raised to minus x divided by 1 minus e raised to minus x the whole square. So if you take this term to the left right hand side, the final answer will be of this form. So this is the total energy of the black body, the total energy of all the Planck's resonators in the black body. So if you want to calculate the average energy is simply total energy divided by total number of resonators. So average energy denoted by E bar is E by N, total energy divided by total number of oscillators. So that will be equal to E into N0 e raised to minus x divided by 1 minus e raised to minus x the whole square. So that is the equation of total energy. And what is the equation for total number? We have already derived that in previous case. It is given by this equation. So I am going to substitute that here. It is equal to N0 into 1 by 1 minus e raised to minus x. So you can clearly see this N0 and N0 will cancel. Similarly, in the denominator we have 1 minus e raised to minus x, and we have here 1 minus e raised to minus x the whole square. One term will get cancelled with this denominator term. So what are the rest of the terms? Simply, we can write the average energy E bar equal to E into e raised to minus x divided by 1 minus e raised to minus x. So if I divide the numerator as well as the denominator with e raised to minus x, it will be E divided by 1 by e raised to minus x, which will be e raised to x minus 1. So this is the equation for average energy of a resonator. So now, assuming the Planck's hypothesis, which assumes that the E, which is the unit of incrementing energy, which is equal to h nu. And if I take that, and also we know nu equal to c by lambda. So applying these two equations into the given equation, you can write what will be E bar. E bar is hc by lambda divided by e raised to x minus 1. And in the previous part we have already substituted x equal to E by kt. X equal to E by kt. And since E equal to h nu, it is h nu by kt. And since nu equal to c by lambda, it is equal to hc by lambda kt. And substituting for x with this equation, you can finally obtain equation for average energy as, which is equal to hc by lambda divided by e raised to hc by lambda kt minus 1. So this is the equation for the average energy of a Planck's oscillator, Planck's resonator, according to Planck's quantum hypothesis. Now, let us calculate the energy density of radiation. So we now have the average energy of each of the resonators. And in order to calculate the energy density of radiation, we need to multiply this average energy with the number of oscillator per unit volume or the density of states. So for that, we need to consider a new term, which is number of oscillators per unit volume. This term is often considered as the density of states in the wavelength region lambda and lambda plus d lambda. So within a short wavelength, how many number of oscillators are there per unit volume? We will be multiplying this factor with the average energy in order to get the energy density. So we will not be deriving this factor. This is another derivation, calculating the density of states. As of now, we will assume the final answer alone. So the number of oscillators per unit volume in the wavelength the wavelength range, the wavelength range lambda and lambda plus d lambda is given by 8 pi into lambda raised to minus 4 d lambda. So we have the number of oscillator per unit volume, or the oscillator density, the density of states, and we will be multiplying this term with the average energy, and hence the final answer for the energy density of radiation, energy density of radiation, between wavelengths lambda and lambda plus d lambda. So this can be obtained by multiplying average energy of a Planck's oscillator with number of oscillator per unit volume. This is equal to average energy multiplied by the density, number of oscillators per unit volume. So we have already calculated the equations for both of them in the previous equation given by equation 4. Equation 4 gives the average energy, and equation 5 gives the density, number of oscillator per unit volume. So multiplying 4 and 5, we can obtain the energy density denoted by E lambda d lambda within the wavelength range d lambda. This is equal to hc by lambda divided by e raised to hc by lambda kt minus 1 multiplied by 8 pi lambda raised to minus 4 d lambda. So simplifying these terms by coordinating, here we have a lambda raised to minus 1 and here we have lambda raised to minus 4. So the final answer will be 8 pi hc lambda raised to minus 5 divided by e raised to hc by lambda kt minus 1 into d lambda. So lambda is the wavelength of the emitted radiation, h is the Planck's constant, c is the speed of light, and other terms were as explained in the previous cases. And this is the equation for the energy density as discussed by the Planck. And this equation is able to successfully account for the black body radiation spectrum that we saw. If you try to plot the curve based on this equation, that is the wavelength along the x-axis and the energy density along the y-axis, the curve will perfectly match with the experimental observations. So you can clearly see that the Planck's quantum hypothesis is able to account for the black body radiation. Until then, the classical theories failed to account for the black body radiation and the spectrum, whereas the simple assumption of Planck that the black body is made up of oscillator and each oscillator is oscillating at discrete ranges of energies helped us to prove that density of states and wavelength, the energy density and wavelength is related by this equation, and this equation is able to successfully explain the spectrum of black body and other basic theories. So if I want to change this equation in terms of nu, here we have an equation with wavelength as the parameter. So if I want to change the equation with parameter being nu, we know nu equal to c by lambda. Then what is d nu? D nu is minus 1 by lambda square, minus 1 by lambda square into c d lambda. C is a constant. 1 by lambda is, the derivative of 1 by lambda is minus 1 by lambda square d lambda. So d lambda will be minus lambda square d nu divided by c. So if you want to change the previous equation into parameter of nu, then this equation will look like E nu d nu equal to 8 pi h nu cube divided by c cube into e raised to h nu by kt minus 1 d nu. So here I have substituted d lambda equal to minus lambda square by c into d nu, and also another equation that we have already learned, which is lambda equal to c by nu. So if you substitute the equations a and b into the previous equation, this final equation 6, then you can finally get the equation for the energy density in terms of frequency of the resonating Planck's resonators. So this equation is able to beautifully explain and beautifully draw the curve of blackbody radiation spectrum, and all the other interesting aspects that we saw about blackbody radiation is totally explained by this Planck's quantum hypothesis and the final Planck's law of blackbody radiation. So we will also see in the next video how the classical theories, the Wien's theory as well as the Rayleigh-Jeans law, are just two approximations of this single theory at certain ranges of wavelength. So in this video, we derived the Planck's law of radiation. I hope this derivation is clear for you. Thank you.